This week we're going to look at how the muscular system works with the skeletal system to produce movements in our body.
This week's quiz will cover both material from last week's lab on the appendicular skeleton, as well as material covered in this week's pre-lab content. We will begin to look at exercise 13, gross anatomy of the muscular system. We'll discuss how muscles are named. We'll discuss important facts about muscles, such as their origin, insertion, innervation, and action. We'll further classify muscles by their shape. And today we'll look at muscles of the head, neck, and trunk. So muscles are named with a number of different criteria. Commonly, they'll be named for the direction that the muscle fibers run. A great example of this is the transverse abdominis in the abdominal region. These muscle fibers run along the transverse plane. Sometimes we name muscles for the location in the body. An example of this would be the muscles of the rotator cuff around the scapula. We have muscles called infraspinatus, supraspinatus, and subscapularis. You may be familiar with terms like bicep and tricep. These refer to the number of origins or the number of heads. Bi meaning two, cephalad meaning heads, biceps or triceps. Location of muscles, origin, and insertion. A favorite of mine is the sternocleidomastoid. The shape of a muscle is another way to name, so the deltoid would be an example of this. And finally, the action of the muscle is another way to name muscles, and I think of muscles of an adductor group in the leg. So every muscle is attached to at least two points. I say two points because we'll learn that muscles of the face actually have an attachment to the skin or to other muscles. But in every case, we have an origin and an insertion. And the origin is going to be the stationary, immovable, or less movable attachment, while the insertion is going to be the movable attachment of that muscle. Each muscle will also have an innervation. The innervation is a group of nerves that stimulate the muscle to contract or to shorten. When we talk about a muscle, we commonly discuss the action of a muscle. And a muscle can contract or relax, but when it actually contracts, it shortens. And then the action that we think of being associated with that muscle is produced. And the action depends on the origin, the insertion, and the fiber type arrangement of the muscle. So here we have a number of different patterns of fiber type arrangement in muscles, and these all are specific to the type of purpose for these muscles. So there's a lot of different muscles to learn over the next several weeks. We specifically will cover the muscles of the head and neck, and what I'm going to do is just suggest a way to basically go from the understanding you have from the last couple weeks of covering the axial and appendicular skeleton, and then adding on top of that knowledge to understand where the muscles are first attached, and then how their actions might actually result in some type of a movement in the body. And this we understand by the origin and insertion point being drawn closer together and in some way then moving the body in a familiar pattern. We are beginning to look at the gross anatomy of the muscular system. I do recognize that most of you have not had any training related to skeletal muscle physiology. What's important for today's lab are a few facts. First, that muscle contracts or relaxes, thereby shortening or lengthening, respectively. Another important thing to understand is the fiber type arrangement, so the direction in which muscle fibers actually run in a muscle. So here's a common example that most of you have seen. This is a steak. It looks delicious, unless you're a vegetarian. When we actually take a cross-section of the steak, we can see that the muscle fibers are arranged in larger groups called fascicles, and these fascicles are running diagonally along the orientation of this muscle fiber. What would happen in a muscle like this is we would shorten along the length of these muscle fibers. So when you look at the different fiber type arrangements, you should understand that this will lend a certain characteristic to the contraction of that muscle. I'm sure by this week in lab, you're pretty comfortable with the visible body software. We started with the Human Anatomy Atlas, and then over the past couple weeks, we worked with the Skeleton Premium software. This week, we're going to start with the Muscle Premium software, and I want to point out a couple of interesting functions that should help you to build on your knowledge from the past couple of weeks. So let's begin by looking at the skeleton views. So if I choose a skeleton view of, let's say, the cervical vertebrae, first interesting thing is that I can highlight the cervical vertebrae individually. And here I've highlighted the atlas. If I'm not certain what I've highlighted, I can always click definition, and that'll give me an explanation of the bone that I've highlighted. If I'm having trouble pronouncing a word, it's always great to click on this little speaker,
atlas,
and you'll get a pronunciation. Now, if I'm interested in a certain origin, and here I'm going to click this pin. By clicking that pin, I've highlighted the origin of the levator scapulae. Now, if I want to look a little bit further at this muscle, I can scroll down, and I can click show pins for a certain area. Now, once I've showed these pins, I can look for the insertion of this muscle. So here I clicked and I saw that the blue area marked here was the insertion of the levator scapulae. Going back to the home screen, I can then look at muscle actions. So levator scapulae is a muscle that is obviously named for its action. So I'm going to look in the area of the shoulder and the arm here, and I'm going to look at scapula elevation. So if I look at scapula elevation, I can see a larger muscle here is doing most of the work, and that's the trapezius. If I look to the front though, I found the muscle that I was just looking at. Again, I can click here for the pronunciation.
Levator scapulae.
And I can get a pronunciation that may sound somewhat like the name. So those are a couple ways to look at muscles. We can always go to regional views, which is going to give us an area that we're interested in. And in this case, it will show us all of the muscles that are in that area. If I go to muscle attachments, here I'm going to get an even more specific look at a certain area, and I'll also have different pins related to that. So I can click always red for the origin and blue for the insertion. So in this week's workbook, what we're doing is basically looking at different muscles of the head, neck, and trunk, and we then will work through the origin, insertion, and action. We're going to save the innervation until we actually look at the peripheral nervous system for you to understand what nerves are going to control these muscles. So we have recommended the Human Anatomy Atlas as a way to study these muscles outside of lab. And this software package should be sufficient to be able to learn the important facts that we're interested in for this week's lab content. If we look at a region like the abdomen, we can see that we can highlight a muscle, we can get the definition of the muscle, including the important facts that we're interested in, the origin, the insertion, and the action. Again, we'll cover innervation several weeks from now when we cover the peripheral nervous system. What we can also do is virtually dissect this model and look at a deeper layer.
Transversus abdominis.
And see what's below in the muscular system. So this should give you a spatial awareness of where muscles lie, an understanding of the direction of the fiber type in muscles, and where they originate or insert, hopefully making you the best detective to understand what the action of that muscle will be. Thank you very much for your attention, and we'll see you next week in lab.